I want you to welcome in John Billingsley.
Howdy, howdy.
All right. Well, I guess I'll start us off with, how did you get into acting?
I moved up to, first off, thank you for having me. Lovely to meet you. Hello, everybody who's listening. I moved up, to answer your question, from the Deep South with my family when I was still fairly young. And in the fifth grade, after having been there for a couple of years, I still had a Southern accent and a lisp and was definitely a pariah, I think, in my public school. We had mandatory class auditions for the school play, which was A Christmas Carol. And because I was always a big reader and was the only one who could seem to read off the page without stumbling and halting, I was cast as Scrooge. So my first acting gig was a starring role. The last time I ever had a starring role, pretty much. And I fell in love with acting primarily out of sheer vanity. For those brief few weeks or months, I was actually lauded. And then, of course, as soon as the show was over, I was back to being a pariah again. And my parents very graciously understood this was something I was really kind of cottoning to, and they helped me matriculate. They got me into classes with some actors who I was in Connecticut who were teaching based out of New York, former soap stars. So I studied acting, you know, casually all through high school. And then when I went to college, I ended up majoring in it.
Wow. So what is your favorite role, or at least maybe your top five favorites?
It's apples and oranges, because you like different things for different reasons. In film and television, probably, there was a short-lived TV show called The Nine on ABC, which came on in, I want to say, 2004. I could be wrong. Didn't last, only 13 episodes, but a terrific cast: Chi McBride, Tim Daly, Kim Raver, about a bank robbery that goes askew. And the folks who are held captive in the bank have life-changing interactions. I thought it was terrific, but it was not a hit commercially. So that was probably the most fun I've ever had. The part was conceived to be a kind of a weenie who turns into a hero. So there was a huge range. So much of what I think happens on television, although this is less so now with limited miniseries, but in the old days, you know, 26 episodes a season, it's sort of episode after episode after episode. There isn't sometimes a lot of variation. There's not a lot of change. Your character is there to perform certain things and hit certain beats the same way every time. The Nine was very much a show about change, about transformation. And for me, that was a really rare opportunity as an actor. On stage, probably a number of different plays by Chekhov, who I think is, you know, for me, sort of right up there with Shakespeare for challenging an actor to really find as much as one possibly can find in what it is to be human. His pieces are so beautiful.
And I'm going to ask, what was it like playing George Marx?
See, now I was curious, because I know that you have expressed a great interest in this. And I was like, we'll see how long it takes for him to get to Cold Case. A fan of the psycho killer you are, eh?
I've got a fascination for them. I watch YouTubers that do like crime things on their YouTube where they talk about people. And George was very fascinating to me. I love the first part episode, just how it just threw it under the bus. Your character was kind of in the background at first. You know, he's like, well, I've got some files to go through. Could take all night. And then it turns it around and he was the one doing everything.
For those who did not see the show, just to set the stage a little bit, Cold Case was on, I don't know how many years ago, a procedural about, was it Philadelphia, I think?
Philadelphia, and I think it was in about 03 or okay. 04.
So Philadelphia police squad that is assigned cold cases, and the series, every episode, you know, kind of goes back in time and has actors playing younger versions of themselves. We see the crime, we see what happened, and then we move to the contemporary era and the cops are trying to solve this crime, and we see the older actors playing the older versions of the younger actors we saw, and truth comes out. So yes, I played a horrible serial killer who was a mild-mannered police, you know, filing clerk, and who turns out to have been a particularly awful serial killer. And they caught on to me, but I'm unflappable, and I do not give them anything that they can use to arrest me, and I get to walk away at the end of the episode. I believe I was the only killer who actually goes, "See ya." Now, they can't let that stand, so of course then they bring me back in the final episode of that season and kill me off, although it was really more for spoiler alert, by the way, if you ever want to watch this, plug your ears right now, because I'm going to give it away. He, in essence, kills himself by giving his nemesis, the lead female detective, a gun and saying, "Go ahead and shoot me, and then you'll be a murderer too." Nyan, 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 nyan. Didn't like the ending very much, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I didn't like the ending of part two either, because I liked that the fact that the character got away, and they kind of went too deep into his backstory, because I'm the type, what you don't know is scarier than what you do know.
Yeah, and I didn't feel like it was, I mean, earned. You know, that's sort of where you feel like the heavy hand of the network is saying, you can't let a brutal serial killer just walk away. He's got to get his comeuppance, and they have to contrive a way for him to be so in a weird way tortured by the female detective that he engineers his own death at her hands. I thought all of that was quite contrived. I thought the first episode was scary and brutal and in a perverse way, consequently sort of enjoyable for me as an actor. The second episode, although I think the director did a terrific job, I was just not a fan of it.
Yeah, that I put that as the number one case on my top 10 cold case episode list, but I said actually that I like the first part better because it leaves you on this whole dark essence, because in reality a lot of people get away with something like that, and a lot of them, the guilty, do walk out.
Yeah, and I couldn't really come up with a legitimate psychological justification for why the guy would engineer his own suicide. You know, I mean, the whole point of it was that sadly, obviously, in this twisted, fucked up world, there are people who take great delight and joy in inflicting pain. And he was one of those people. For him to choose to end his life did not seem to me to be in any way legitimate. It was purely called for by whether it was a network or not, it was called for by the, you know, the storytelling god saying, you can't let that vileness, you know, go unpunished. But it was fun to do. I mean, I have to say, I have played a peculiarly large number of creeps in my career. Child molesters and psycho killers and, you know, you name it, running the gamut. That was perhaps one of the more notable ones.
Well, I actually showed my little sister the episodes. And
what a good brother you are.
Yep, I'm a big brother. Interesting one. She's 20 now. She just turned 20. Anyway, I just showed her the episodes in October. And when we were watching, she's like, I know him. He's in one of the Air Buddy movies.
Air Buddy movies? I don't think so.
No, not Air Buddies. It's the same Santa Paws or something. I can't remember the
name. Oh, 12 Dogs of Christmas?
That's it.
Okay, well, that's an interesting reference. People know you from odd things. Yes, that was a rather, I thought, obscure children's movie that my wife and I did together. But I guess it has its partisans somewhere. But a small little town back in the 30s that for some obscure reason bans dogs. And I'm the evil dog catcher.
So. Actually, I think you were also in Station 19 with your wife, too, weren't you?
Very good. Yes, I was in Station 19. Yes, we owned an ice skating rink, and I had an unfortunate episode on the ice. I was trapped on the ice with a killer Zamboni. It's like, you know what? Cash the check still cashes. I don't show them. I just do them.
Which is ironic, because you were also in the, I guess, Grey's Anatomy universe. You were also in Grey's Anatomy.
I've been in a lot of things. I was in Grey's Anatomy. Yes, I was impaled. I was actually taken from my home because I'd had a heart attack in an ambulance, and the ambulance arrives in the ambulance bay. There's an automobile accident involving the ambulance, and I am further injured. I am impaled with a sharp piece of metal. So bad day for that guy. Most of that episode, I was unconscious, I believe. I think I had an episode. This is the time I used to have a little song I'd sing, 6 days off and the checks still come, when I was on Enterprise, because I wouldn't always necessarily be the guy who's called on to work. That was an episode where it's like, hey, you're going to give me a paycheck and I just have to lie on a gurney and basically pretend to let you operate on me while I'm sound asleep.
Well, if it makes you feel better, the 2020 episodes of Grey's Anatomy, Ellen Pompeo basically just slept that entire season and she got paid for it.
There you go. I'm not actually a huge television watcher. I like to read. And so oddly, I came from the stage and moving into film and television. One of the first things you hear is, well, you have to know all this, all this product, you have to be familiar with it all. And if you had to watch everything on television and kind of keep abreast of everything that's going on, you would watch television and go to the movies and to the exclusion of all other things. I'm more of the mind that it's there on the page. The scene gives you what you need to know to do the work. And I don't spend a lot of time watching a lot of stuff unless it really falls into my sweet spot and I'm genuinely interested. And that's a relatively small sliver of stuff. I'm watching Succession right now, which I think is great. I think Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul were terrific. I'll watch a bunch of streaming stuff, but one show at a time and no more than a few hours a week.
Well, we're in the middle of rewatching Cobra Kai seasons 1 through 4, so I can't say anything. But I had just rewatched Cold Case in October, and it had blown my mind on how good the show actually was. I watched it on HBO Max.
Okay.
And when I got right to your episode, because I had watched it with my mom when I was a teen, I never got to see the ending episode. But when I got to the first part, I was like, oh, crap, this guy, George, he's terrifying. And they do the genius writing of just making him a background character at first.
It's always the background character. It's pretty much any procedural you ever watch. You can pretty much guess who the villain is. It's like, oh, who's that guy? That's a recognizable face. He doesn't have anything to do. He must be the killer. Actually, now that I'm older and I'm in things and I have sometimes smaller parts, people say, I was sure it was you. I was sure you'd be the killer. How could you? Why did you do that? You didn't have anything to do. It's like, because they gave me a check.
Well, the things I noticed with it, they do kind of play up like the kind of serial killer trivia. They named the alias that George uses as Peter Brodsky. And he was a guy that wrote a book about serial killers.
Oh, well, see. Psh. Didn't know that.
See, me with my fun, pointless trivia of knowing nothing.
But I'm sure you know, you actually, in communicating to me and asking me to do this and suggested that you want to talk about this, I said, I didn't really remember that much. I was stunned at how much you remembered or how much you researched. It was like, I forgot about, right.
I'd have to say my favorite part with him throughout the whole run was not his actions, but when he was being interrogated.
Yes, those are fun. Those are fun scenes and, a lovely cast. And, you know, you're never sure. You're never really entirely sure. It always is contingent upon what the director is looking for, what the size of the performance wants to be, you know. So they kind of encourage me to kind of like, you know, let it elbow out a little bit more. It's like, okay. So
my favorite portion of that, well, I know that everyone's
more theatricalized, say, I mean, than you know, many, many times you would be asked to contain it and make it very small. They actually wanted a little more size to it, which is kind of fun.
I like what he said to Danny Pino's character, Scotty, where he's like, well, this guy is probably someone who has real trouble with the ladies. And then George just fires back with, if there's anyone with a lady problem, it's you.
Yes, yes, I remember that. Yes, he was quite adept at getting under everybody else's skin. It's sort of where you begin to feel like the fundamental artificiality of television is that is going to then, of course, have to redound against him, and Lily is going to get under his skin by suggesting that he was too much of a simp to even be able to qualify as a private security guard. And she laughs at him, and he's like, don't laugh at me. That's sometimes where I kind of feel like, you know, television has to kind of, you know, they want to have its cake and eat it too. They want the person to be, you know, the mastermind, but to be extremely vulnerable himself. You insulted me! So, you know, it's like, it's television, it's fine. You know, make your allowances.
Which it barely worked, because he was actually the only person interrogator that actually got under her skin.
Yes. And I wish, you know, again, it's just the nature of episodic television. You have to hit certain beats. If you're going to do an episodic TV show, they can't let the villain win. So they had to give her, even in that episode, when I walk away, they had to suggest that she had gotten under his skin, and that, you know, you knew pretty much that he was going to be coming back, that she was going to get him. In fact, I was waiting after that episode. It's like, okay, TikTok, they're going to have to come back and have me back. They're not going to let me get away. So when they called me again, it was like, yeah, okay, I want a salary bump. And they were like, what? Outrageous. You know. He's like, well, no, sorry. I want a little more money. Yeah, that's how the television business works. You very rarely have leverage as an actor.
I think my favorite quote, though, is, I think I might leave town. Do some traveling.
Oh, yes. Now, are you a Star Trek fan?
Yes, I am.
That's probably the other thing. I'm only in the interest of whether or not other people who are watching this watched that episode. They might be thinking, all right, well, I didn't even see this. So what else has the guy been in? Star Trek is probably the thing I'm most known for. And in response to an earlier question of yours, is probably one of the other things, of course, that for me has been, you know, kind of a highlight of my career, that getting to play a guy who's the exact opposite of George, not a serial killer at all. He's the jolliest alien in the universe, probably closer to my own temperament than anybody else I've ever played.
Oh yeah, he's probably one of my favorite characters on Star Trek of all time, and I would actually put him above, say, Captain Kirk even.
Take that, Bill Shatner. If you're watching this, Bill Shatner, you just got dissed.
Yes, he did.
I sat on Bill Shatner's lap one time.
How did that go?
We were going to a convention in Seattle, and we were on the same plane ride. The plane landed, and apparently our driver was late. I grokked immediately that we were waiting for the same driver. Bill didn't know me from Adam, so he was kind of looking impatiently at his watch and getting on his phone, calling his assistant. And I walked up merely to say, hey, you know, I just heard from the driver they're running a few minutes late. And I get the Shatner wave off. It's like, I'm on Star Trek, motherfucker. I don't want your autograph. I'm just here telling you that the car is coming. So anyway, it's like the car comes, and they send, for some reason, like a Honda Civic. And it's him and his assistant and me and my wife, the driver, and another person all trying to, you know, it's like, why don't we pick up a couple of clowns and a few lap dogs on the way? See how many people we can get into this Volkswagen. So I ended up sitting on Shatner's lap, you know, on the way into Seattle. It was like, well, this is probably a lot of fans' dream. Me, I'm like, could you step on the gas, please? How quickly can we get there?
What was Leonard Nimoy like, though?
I never met Leonard. No, actually, ironically, because in that car ride, Bill, I don't know what to call him. After I sit in his lap, you think I'm entitled to call him by his first name? Bill. Was wanting to know if there are any places he might recommend for lunch, and I used to live in Seattle, so I said blah 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 blah. And he won't say grudgingly, because I'm sure this was a genuine, you know, invitation. I appreciated at the time. It's like, well, would you like to join Leonard and I for lunch? It was like, no. Realize that probably every fan's dream is to kind of sit down and have lunch with Spock and Kirk, but it's like, no, you're pals, you're wanting to get together. I'm not going to crash your lunch and have it be a little, you know, no. So there was my chance to have lunch in Seattle with Kirk and Spock. Passed it up.
What's your opinion on the new Star Trek stuff? Like Star Trek, the not the next. Well, yeah, the next generation.
Well, and I mean, the new, if you new, if you mean Discovery and Picard and the two animated shows, and they've got another one in the works that I think is supposed to be set at the Starfleet Academy. That'll probably be like a WB version of Star Trek. I mean, remarkable the legacy of Star Trek from 1966 to today to see it having this resurgence. I mean, there are a number of times, including at the end of the show I was on, Enterprise, with Scott Bakula, when I thought, you know, that's it, that's the last coffin nail, and always up from the dead, always a new generation of people that are very receptive to the stories and Roddenberry's vision. On an individual level, as to the shows themselves, again, I don't really watch a lot of television, so I don't, I've seen a couple of episodes of Discovery. It, well done, as far as I could tell. I didn't stick with it, and I've not seen Picard, and I've not seen the animated shows, so I'm not. And to be honest with you, I never saw Deep Space Nine either. I only watched a couple episodes of Voyager, even the episodes of the Enterprise that I wasn't on. It'd be like, yeah, maybe I'll see that in reruns. But really, I always would rather be reading a book, if truth be told.
That's pretty much how I was in school too, and pretty much how I am still. I still read. I mean, constantly.
Oh, I don't mean to sound snobby about it. I always find myself, you know, it's sort of weird. It's like I'm an actor and I end up having interviews in which people are asking me about this, that, and the other. It's like, I don't know. I didn't see it.
Did you base your character from Enterprise off of anyone? Maybe from a book or no?
No. They don't give you a lot to go on. You know, the audition, they don't give you the script. Just sometimes you get the script, you know, actually more often than not for a pilot, you're going to get the script. In this instance, I didn't have the script. I just had a scene and all they said was come in with a slight alien accent. And they may have said something that the character is buoyant or, you know, clearly on the page he is. And he's somebody who's, you know, optimism captain was his signature, is somebody who had a tremendous. So you don't really base it on it. I mean, I don't, maybe other actors do. I don't ever think about another individual. I try and think about, well, what is this guy's backstory? What is it that makes him who he is? What are his circumstances and what does he want in the scene? What is he fighting for? That's really how an actor works. You try and figure out what it is you're trying to achieve in the scene. What is your action? What is your intention? What are you fighting for? Any kind of impersonation, when you start thinking about this other person, I'm going to try and capture him, you get into your head. You become self-conscious. It isn't, I think, a very effective way to go about doing the work. So it was more like, what motivated the guy? You know, I mean, what I did think is, because they didn't give you any information about Denobula or Denobulans, and it's like, well, okay, this species has never been on Star Trek before. Nobody can tell me anything about it, so I'll make up a backstory. And in my imagination, we were like a monastic race. There are only six of us left. For me, it was like going off into space was like, well, there's nothing to do on my home planet. The other five people are boring. I'm going to go have adventures. And then I found out, I find out later on, in fact, we're like, you know, like fuck bunnies. We all have like multiple wives and multiple husbands. It's the most crowded planet in the cosmos. We're living cheek to jowl. It's like, ah. He wanted to get away for an entirely different set of reasons. You never know.
That's normally how it works. How was the makeup for the character?
It was not exceptionally onerous. You get used to it, I should say. It was about 2.5 hours in the chair. So on those days when I had full days and I had to get there at 5 a.m. and I was the last one to leave, and it's 45 minutes getting out of the makeup and getting cleaned up, with the eyeballs on. Those were long days. Those were long, arduous days, 16-ish hour days or more. However, was the only character actor really on a show full of, you know, sexy young people. Scott Bakula is older than I am, but he could bench press me 5 times over. So he still counts as young in my book. And they're all the ones who got to, you know, woo the alien babes and fire the phase pistols and throw punches and, you know, all the stuff that I didn't want to do in the first place. So I had a pretty cushy gig. When I worked, it was demanding, but I liked the character and I got a lot of time off. And the producers were nice. They let me go off and look for other gigs. I did a bunch of shows actually at the same time I was on Enterprise, at least in the first 2 years. kind of began to scale that back in the third and fourth season. They began to use me maybe a smidge more, I thought, and it was a little harder to get away.
Was there ever a performance that you really didn't like doing, like one that tired you out, got you exhausted?
I've never been a great fan of being in stunts. I ain't no athlete. I never have been. So anytime, you know, they've got you, I think I did an episode of The Rookie, a couple years ago. And again, I was a psycho killer. I was an older man who'd been arrested, who'd been brought to a hospital. They thought he had dementia, was wandering around, poor soul, poor sod. It turns out that actually he did have dementia, but in his lucid moments, he assaulted people. So at some point, the penny drops for me and for everybody else, and they come to arrest me, and I've skedaddled. And there's this long sequence where I'm running down the hospital corridors and elbowing people aside and running down a stairwell, and I'm tackled by the cop, and we throw it. Boom, 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 boom. When I have to do that shit, it's like a stunt person does a lot of it, maybe even the bulk of it, but you still have to do enough of it. It's like, I didn't sign up for this. I'm too old. I like scenes where I'm like, you know, sitting in a chair, speaking reasonably about reasonable things to reasonable people.
Unless you're George, who he was sitting in a chair, but he wasn't being very reasonable.
Well, George had to go get in fatigues and walk around in the woods and carry a big rifle and wear some ridiculous gizmo on his face. There are physical actors. I mean, like Tom Cruise, you know, notoriously is like, no, I'll rappel down that building. I eschew a stunt person. For me, it's like, stunt man, stunt double. Thank you. I'm paid to speak, and I have a gestural vocabulary, but if you want somebody to scale a building, get a building scaler.
Now, I do wonder, was that you in the flashbacks also as George, or?
Oh, you're consumed with George. You are. You're a psycho. I knew you said you'd talk about this a lot, but I'm not going to let you. Go on. Move forward. Other questions. I don't remember. I don't know. I was on that show 25 years ago.
25 years?
Well, 30 years ago, 20 years ago, 15 years ago, a long fucking time ago.
I'm just breaking with you. You know me.
I know. Well, I don't know you at all. I'm meeting you now for the first time. You don't know me. I'm going to give you shit. What else? What else you want to talk about?
Maybe I do know you. No. I was wondering, can you still do your character's voice from Enterprise?
No. I mean, I could if I listened to it, but I haven't, I haven't really watched. I think I've caught a few episodes on reruns on Netflix while, you know, channel surfing, or, you know, just idly kind of like, oh, right. But I would need to. It wasn't far away from mine. But I remember every off season before we went back into production, I a week or so before we started shooting again, I'd go back to the, you know, back to the tapes just to try and put the voice back in my head. I didn't want it to be far removed from mine, but it was a bit removed. At least it had a lilt. I think when I initially went in to audition, I sort of, to the extent I had any notion at all, I was sort of giving it a little bit of the East Indian sort of uptick, you know? Because it struck me that he was in a way sort of a, you know, he had kind of an East Indian, he had an Indian philosophy, you know, eternal return, et cetera, et cetera.
What's your favorite movie persona or character that you've played?
I've had a much deeper TV than movie career. One of the things that can happen in Hollywood is that you can get a bit ghettoized. If you have a resume that leans heavily towards television, this has changed somewhat over the course of the last decade or so with streaming and with the cultivation of more sophisticated television material. But I found that I had a harder time getting a lot of traction in movies. Probably the movie that I, from a limited number of legitimate films, I say legitimate films, a lot of them, it's like, oh, I hope you never run across that. But some of the better films I've done, probably out of time with Denzel Washington. I played his sidekick. And there wasn't, you know, any great shakes necessarily as a script. It was kind of a, you know, a old B movie, but it was well done. Eva Mendes and Sena Lathan and Dean Cain was the villain. And it was fun. Carl Franklin, a terrific director, did a great job with it. So although it was, it had, you know, a lot of the potboiler about it, it was kind of snazzy. And that was probably the most, the movie I'm the most recognized for. But honestly, so many of the movies I've done have been kind of like, you know, either they never saw the light of day or I wished they'd never seen the light of day. I can't. I do not have, it's odd because, you know, people ask me to do an interview and I always feel like, sure, I have no huge regard for my oeuvre. I lucked out and managed to make a living as an actor. It's a tough business. I got to do something I dig. I got to sock away enough money to live comfortably. I spent a lot of my time working to help a not-for-profit called the Hollywood Food Coalition here in Los Angeles, which rescues food and shares it with multiple not-for-profits and people in need. We serve a hot multi-course meal every night of the week. Frankly, most of the time, if I'm doing podcasts, it's so I can speak to it and speak to that work and speak to volunteerism generally, which is something I like to try and promote and encourage people to do. I'm fairly a flip about my career because I don't think it's any great shakes.
Well, you've got fans. I'm obviously one of them.
God bless you. God bless you. You bought me a house. I appreciate it.
That's what I'm here for, except for some shows haven't got a DVD release yet, which makes me sad. But do you prefer playing a villain or a good guy or the neutral guy?
I don't really think of it in those terms. It's more about the quality of the script. And if there's anything that you're kind of looking for, I suppose, as an actor, and it's not like I'm in a position where I get to pick and choose my parts. I mean, really, I am a I'm a blue-collar lunch bucket actor, you know. You audition, you get a gig, you show up, you do the best you can, you go home. It's your gig. It's your job. So if I make a lot of jokes about I got that paycheck, it's because I did not reach a rung on a ladder that allowed me the luxury of choice. So I kind of put out of my head, do I like this or prefer that? It's like, you know, I was a working stiff actor. Now I'm kind of, you know, quasi semi demi retired. I give a lot more of my time and energy to the Hollywood Food Coalition than I do to pursuing work. But back in the day, you know, it's like you get an audition and you do the best you can with it and you don't try and judge it. If you're lucky, you have opportunities to play characters that just have an arc where they learn something along the way. They go through a transformation. There's a discovery. They have a journey. Sometimes, and probably more often than not, particularly if you're a guest star, you're there to advance a narrative. Frequently, you're there just to convey information. And you're basically there to go, well, when I went to the nuclear emissions reactor, I found out that yada, 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 and this information, I think this should be conveyed to. And that's your role. And it's like, whatever. You know, so on television, a lot of crime dramas, you're the red herring, you're the person they initially suspect, but you're the murder victim, in which case your role usually consists of, you know, I'm going to have to go to the police and I was on NYPD Blue a few times, and there was a couple of episodes where I was a cab driver who had taken to murdering his fares because he was a racist. And he ended up murdering young black men because he thought they wanted to rob him because he had been robbed. So, you know, he was justified. And that I thought was a very interesting part. I always liked that show, and they were very gracious to me, and they gave me a lot of range in terms of how I might want to do it. And although that I don't know, I think that show is still available and seen. Not that many people reference it anymore, so I think it's sort of, you know, a bit lost in the mists of time. But that was a role I was fairly proud of.
It was a pretty good one. I think I remember it. I used to watch it. My grandparents, they love shows like that. Yeah. So we would all watch that. They were really big fans of NCIS too. So
Yeah, I was on that. I was a blind photographer on that.
That was a show I remember you from too.
I didn't think that was that much that interesting about that part, but yeah, NCIS. I mean, I know there's so many of them. I mean, CSI here, CSI there, CSI your house, CSI my house, NCIS every state, every village, every county, every, you know, it's like they all kind of blur in your mind.
It's kind of like Law and Order. Like, which one do you want to watch?
Yeah.
Do you want to watch the one with Private Pyle from Full Metal Jacket? Or
and perversely, if you're an actor, you know, I mean, the reality is that a lot of those shows, and I don't mean to sound like I'm, you know, insulting the industry. I mean, every show has its fan base, and let 100 flowers bloom, as Mao said. Mao. Don't make me. I'm not a Maoist. I do personally find that the thing about those crime shows is that they're incredibly repetitive. However, they also are lucrative because they're the ones that get syndication deals. So to the extent that a lot of an income for an actor is kind of like, you know, residual income, you in the long run are better off doing NCIS or CSI than you are doing a prestigious cable drama, which shows on Netflix. And in terms of its long running life, pays you pennies. So there's a strange, you know, the art pulls you to want to do X, the commerce leads you to say I'll take Y, which is why I now help run a not-for-profit. It's like, hey, I'll just let it all go.
That's always a good way to be too. I mean, anyway, I want to say thank you so much for coming on and being a guest.
Of course.
I really do appreciate it. Is there anything you'd like to close out the video with?
Well, I will give one more plug for the Hollywood Food Coalition. If anybody's interested, they could check us out at hofoco.org. We recently, for those who are watching who are Star Trek fans, did an event on January 15th, a digital fundraiser for the Hollywood Food Coalition, 8 hours of panels with various Star Trek celebrities. That's available still to watch on YouTube. Look up Trek Talks. You can find it at Roddenberry Entertainment or TrekGeeks.com. I think it's .com. And if you watch it and enjoy it and you care to make a contribution to the Hollywood Food Coalition, we do great work in our community. And we're also really invested in the fight to try and find systemic change-oriented solutions to issues of poverty and hunger. So you are supporting a cause bigger than the organization seeming purpose, which is just to serve people in Los Angeles. We are really out to try and help figure out solutions for our country to do a better job feeding people in need.
You can also find a link to that in my description on the video.
Fabulous.
Thank you. And thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Think twice, 'cause it's another day for you. You're in paradise.